Hey guys, today we're going to ancient China. Before I do that, of course, I need to give credit where credit is due. I did a lot of my research with Ducksters, the Council for Economic Education, East Asia in Geographic Perspective, the DBQ Project, the Ancient History Encyclopedia, Crash Course World History Number 9, highly recommend, good one to watch, find it on YouTube, and National Geographic course. There's a lot of information, just this teeniest, tiniest little bit of the tip of the iceberg that is ancient China that we're going to be looking at. I'm still going to need to break up into at least three videos, if not more. The first one, this one, is Introduction to Ancient China. The second one will be The Silk Road, which is a lot of fun. I like doing that one a lot. And the third one, of course, will be The Great Wall of China. We're going to be doing a lot with the Great Wall of China in the coming days, so hang on to your hats about that. But right now, let's get this started. Part one, Introduction to Ancient China. You should have some Cornell notes in front of you that you need to correct. If you don't have those, pause this video, go get those, come on back, unpause, and let's go. So, like with every other civilization, we're going to talk about where ancient China got its start. And like nearly all the other ancient civilizations that we've looked at this year, China got its start along rivers. Shocking, I know. Major centers of civilization started along the Huanghe River, we call it the Yellow River, and the Changjiang River, we call it the Yangtze. Both these rivers leave lots of silt behind, and as we have discovered, leaving silt behind is a really, really good thing for farming, and the Chinese, like other civilizations, took advantage of it. Geographically, China is pretty well protected from, I'm going to hide myself here for a second, but I'll speak up. China is pretty well protected from invaders. In the north and the west, you see the steppes, which are like long plains lands, fairly flat, no forest, like prairies. They're plateaus as well. There are high, flat areas and deserts, mainly the Gobi Desert, which is the third largest desert in the world, and then the Taklamakan Desert. In the south, there are mountains, and those of you that read Peak, and that should be all of you, should know that. The same range that Everest is in, the Himalayas. And in the east, of course, there's the Pacific Ocean. In fact, there's so much harsh land in China that only 1/10 of it can be farmed. So as far as like anybody like walking across to invade the villages near the rivers, it's not going to happen. It was not easy for outsiders to get in. So let's talk about their farming. Unlike Mesopotamia and Egypt, where wheat and barley were their main crops, or in the Mayan civilization and the ancient Amerindians, where their main crops were maize, corn, right? The main crop in China was rice. Well, sort of. In the north, it was wheat, which is very similar to some of the civilizations we've already looked at. It was in the south where rice could grow well. Rice has to have pretty specific conditions in which to grow well. And in the south, it was rice as their main crop. But we are already seeing similarities with other civilizations. Rivers, wheat, that kind of thing. Now, like nearly all the other civilizations that we've looked at, China took a long time to come together as a unified country. It took literally thousands of years for everything to come together and become the modern China that we know today. Now, I have to go over some dynasties really quickly. We've had that word before. It's a vocabulary word. It means a family that rules over a area, a country, whatever, for quite some time. And if you will remember, in Egypt, there were 18 dynasties. 18. In China, ancient China, or not ancient China, all the way up to modern China, there were 16 dynasties, and many of them were interrupted by civil wars or revolutions or revolts or things like that. But some were very successful. I want to talk about, well, one in particular, one of the very early ones. In fact, it's the fifth one. So let me get my timeline out here. The first one is the Xia dynasty. The Xia, that's how you say that. The Xia dynasty. And they were in power from 2205 BCE to 1575 BCE. And then in 1570 BCE, the Shang dynasty took power. And they were in power till, 1045 BCE. And then we have, you pronounce this one the Zhou dynasty, from about 1045 BCE all the way over to 256 BCE. I love these guys. They tried really hard. This is pronounced Qin, the Qin dynasty, 221 to 206. And then finally from 206 to 220 CE, they did really well. The Han dynasty. And these are the guys that I want to talk about. How the Han Dynasty came into being was that there was a peasant revolt against the Qin Dynasty. The people, the peasants, thought that the Qin Dynasty was way too strict. They were legalists, if that means anything to anybody, but probably not. And the peasants, the people who had no power, had finally had enough of being punished for things that they thought were ridiculous after a while. And they fought back. That's a revolt. The revolt, or the fighting back, was led by a man named Liu Bang. And he would go on to be the emperor of the Han Dynasty. And he would change his name to Han Gaozu. Emperor Han did a lot of things to stabilize China and make things a little more equal. He created a civil service. In other words, he set up a government in such a way that educated men could become a part of the government and help him rule China instead of him just doing it by himself. And this is good in the beginning. This will eventually evolve into a testing situation in which educated men could were the only people who could take the test. And if you were educated, that meant you were rich. So only rich people could take this test to work in the government. And it started out good and kind of turned kind of bad later on. But we're not going to worry about that right now. Another thing that happened during the Han Dynasty is that paper was invented. And here I have a I have an example for you. Let me get it. Yeah, paper. Paper. Big whoopee, right? Well, but we have talked about what people wrote on back in ancient times. We've talked about Mesopotamian clay tablets. We've talked about Egyptian papyrus. But now we have paper. And the first paper was very economically created. It was created out of old rags and old fishing nets and things like that. But it was used for the same purposes. It was used to keep records, to keep receipts. Nobody invents writing because they just have the great novel in them. They write it because they don't want to get messed up with the people they're doing business with. So they write receipts. They keep records. But the thing is, this invention of this highly portable, user-friendly way to keep records creates opportunities to do other things, like, I don't know, draw maps of land, draw maps for the military in case you need to tell them where to go, that kind of thing. It also, think about it, it also gets used as packing material if you have to send something to someone, a bottle of something or a clay pot of something, and it's too fragile to go on its own, crinkle up some paper, put it in there next to it, it'll keep it safe. So we can now transport things more easily that couldn't have been transported before. if you layer it and make it hard, those of you that have decoupaged or mod podged, you know how hard paper can get. Well, you do it right and you shape it in such a way, you can create armor, a pretty cheap armor to go into battle with. A lot cheaper than iron, a lot cheaper than bronze. You can make it thin. Put windows in your house. You will eventually, maybe not you, but back in the olden days, will make it into money. So let's talk about the living conditions really quick in the Han Dynasty. In the Han Dynasty, if you were rich and educated and lived in the city, things were great. Emperor Han had dropped the taxes, not dropped them, but reduced them. And if you had enough money, you could go to school. There was no stopping you. On the other hand, if you were poor and lived in the city, well, sometimes there wasn't enough food. Sometimes there wasn't even a place to live. So it was very, very tough being poor and living in the city and having no resources. Now, if you were poor in the country, it was a little different story. There's usually food. There's usually shelter. Rich people particularly didn't live in the country, living in the city was a really tough way to go if you didn't have the resources. Finally, the social structure of China, ancient China, the Han China. The social structure of Han China was very complicated, very rigid, and that meant that the level you were born at, the social level you were born at, that was it. You probably weren't moving. You were probably pretty stuck. Craftsmen and doctors and farmers were ranked pretty high on the social scale. Well, interestingly, merchants were quite low. And I say interestingly, because during the Han Dynasty, it was during the Han Dynasty that merchants could get pretty rich. And one of the reasons that merchants could get rich during the Han Dynasty was the Silk Road. And we'll talk about that next time.